As part of our quest to curate inspiring stories about diversity and inclusion, we decided to meet with Sally Krawcheck and share some of her learnings and insights. So the first one would be, what's your definition of diversity?
Can you bring in people who think differently from each other? That's where the real magic happens. That's where the real innovation happens. That's where I believe the better business performance happens. That is driven in turn by diversity of background, diversity of education, diversity of nationality, diversity of experience, diversity of skin color, diversity of orientation.
That's a good answer.
Well, thank you.
If you think about, you have your own background in Wall Street, yeah. And now you're an entrepreneur. If you would give one piece of advice, what would that be?
Yeah, just do it. You know, enough about the Diversity Council and enough about the pipeline and enough about the additional activity or into the mentoring program, into a sponsorship program. You know, we've been talking about this for forever at this stage. And middle management is where diversity goes to die. Because the biases or the way we've been socialized as individuals are so powerful that if you are only promoting or hiring a couple or a few people a year and you're not in this day to day, then you're going to bring in the person who just reminds you so darn much of yourself, mm-hmm. right? And so would you believe that meritocracies are the least diverse? You'd think they'd be the most diverse, right? Because we're going to take away all of the stuff about skin color and orientation and gender and just promote the best people. But somehow the best people end up being the people who remind us of ourselves so darn much. And so as CEOs, we can, you know, you can continue to make the speech at the town hall and say we need to do it. You can continue to pay people 5% of their bonus based on it. These things haven't worked and they're not going to work because that socialization is so strong. In order to do it, you have to just do it. Our product and engineering group is half women. Our company overall is 40% people of color. And what I have done is when those numbers start to get out of whack, and which for us typically means we're hiring another Caucasian woman, I will stop the hiring. Okay. And, well, we looked for a person of difference for this role. We couldn't find one. Oh, we live in New York City. There's only white women for this role? I don't think so. And I will stop the hiring. Well, aren't you disempowering your managers? Yeah, you know, I am, because if we as a group have committed to have a diverse and inclusive company that represents our customers and represents the world at large, when we start to veer off of it, rather than saying, gosh, you know, I'm so confused, I don't know what to do, I've got to let the managers manage, you say, this is what we committed to do as a group, and we will not hire until we can find, you know, that individual or those individuals who meet the requirements. Because it's not just filling the job, it's building a team of the company. And so an individual might be the right person for the job or the best person for the job, but it doesn't necessarily mean they're the best person for the complexion of the company, for the overall makeup of the company.
So it sounds very simple, actually.
Yeah, it's not that hard.
What do you think are the main factors why this diversity and inclusion or equality, why it's going so slowly? What is really holding back the companies to get there?
Look, I think a couple of things are holding us back. One of which is the way we've been socialized is so strong. So let me take the example of women. We know that we've been socialized such that as men become more successful, we perceive them as more likable. As women become more successful, we perceive them as unlikable. So all of a sudden, the women who are getting to senior levels, we don't like them very much. We're not dying to promote them. We've been socialized such that we promote people in the majority, in this case white males, based on potential, and we promote women and minorities based on performance. When men are said to be looking for power or attention, we think men are men. We've been socialized to believe that when women look for power and attention, there's something off about that. And the emotion that it evokes in us, women and men, is one of sort of moral outrage and disgust. And so I remember having one boss who loved the fact that I, as one of the few senior women on Wall Street, I had a high profile. And another boss, the next boss, who screamed at me for it, told me to get my profile down. And when I said, well, the only interviews I've done have been ones the company have asked me to do, so I don't understand what I'm doing wrong. I think it might just be because, one, the business is doing well, and two, because I'm this oddity, which is a senior woman, he didn't want to have the discussion. He said, it's your problem, you take care of it, right? And you could feel from him radiating this sense of moral outrage that I was getting attention. Do I believe in quotas? I'm supposed to say no. No, it's so un-American, quotas. I want to make it there on my own. But what we're doing isn't working. What we're doing isn't working. And so I'm up for anything that can work, not just because it's the right thing to do, but because it's a smart thing for our economy and our society. And so the next wave, I do believe, is going to be women coming together, employing their diversity councils to engage with management, to have more, I won't say women-friendly, but people-friendly policies, to demand more women are being promoted, to demand equal pay, et cetera, et cetera. So I'm thinking that's the next wave. If that doesn't work, I'm all for quotas.